It is raining.
No, please!
Lightning flashes.
No! Please!
Thunder booms.
No! Don't! Don't!
A child cries. The young boy pleaded as tentacles reached out at him. He fell to the ground and desperately clawed at the wet mud to prevent from being carried away. A man laughed at the six-year-old's futile attempt of escape as the tentacles dragged him towards the blood-red portal.
I'm sorry, but if I can't have him, then I'll take you.
Sobbed, and suddenly at those words, the man held his hand out and the tentacle stopped dragging the boy.
Anything, you say?
The man asked, and the boy was so afraid that he nodded quickly.
Will you work for me?
Yes! Yes, I will! Please let me go!
The man smiled evilly.
As you wish.
He snapped his fingers and the tentacles pulled away from the boy, who curled into a fetal position as the man walked towards the portal.
I will go now, and I will stay away for a long time. But one day I will come for you, and you will work for me. You will not be able to say no. You will have no decision in this matter, because it's either you work for me, or I drag you back down to where you belong. Understand?
The young boy nodded and the man laughed.
Good. I have a feeling this will be a long and healthy working relationship. I will see you soon, Sora Shimomura.
The man disappeared, leaving Sora in the rain. Being a boy of young age, all he could do was curl up and cry. He cried with fear and sadness. Little did the boy know that this dark, horrible, rainy day would be the day that would define him for the rest of his life.
Years later.
Sora, you need to wake up. You can't be late for your first day of school.
Sora woke from his fearful nightmare. Memories of that dark, rainy night plagued him, and even after 6 years, he woke in a fearful cold sweat. He sat up and rubbed his eyes wearily. He hated the first day of a new school. His mom, being a single parent, worked throughout most of the day. So the first day of a new school was always terror, especially since this day was the first day of high school, a different high school than the one his other friends are going to, which meant Sora would be an outcast for the first day, and he hated more than anything. He ran downstairs and found his mother at the table waiting for him. She had gotten up early and had breakfast all ready for him.
Morning, sleepy.
She teased. Sora grumbled a response and sat down at the table. Silently eating his breakfast, it was harder than usual because his mother was also making sure he remembered everything.
You have the cell phone, right?
Sora nodded.
You know the number to my cell?
Sora hesitated. She told him before, but it left his head. The silence told his mother he couldn't remember.
It's in the contact list, but I'm also on speed dial.
Sora nodded in affirmation. With his mother's questions out of the way, he went back to his breakfast. As he was finishing up, the honk of the bus horn was heard, and Sora was suddenly hurried to move. He would have been out the door sooner, but his mother was once again slowing him down with reminders.
You have your backpack?
It's over my shoulder, Mom.
You have your cell phone?
It's in my pocket, Mom.
Are you wearing underwear?
Mom! Yes, I have underwear!
Just making sure you were listening.
She gave a knowing smile.
You remember my number?
It's in the contact list. I'll try and have it memorized.
Good.
She said. Watching her son walk to the front door, she called out.
Wait, Sora.
Sora paused as she walked over to the front door, pushed her blonde hair out of her face, and gave her son a kiss.
Your father would be proud.
Sora flinched. If his father was so great, then where the hell is he? Sora only knew his father for 5 years, and then bam, he was out of his life. Sora didn't know nor care where he went. He just wanted to forget about him. But it was hard when his mom kept making comments like, "Your father would be proud," or the ever popular, "Like father, like son." Either way, Sora was tired of it, but he let her get away with it because he knew she cared about him.
Right, Mom. Well, goodbye.
Sora nodded and he ran for the school bus. Sora's house was set upon a hill, and due to the old lark wood that the house was made of, it had seen better days. His mom would love to fix it, but being a single parent, the money she earned went to getting food for her and her son. The school bus refused to drive up the hill, so Sora had to run down the road to get to the bus before it took off. By the time he finally made it, he was already tired and he was met with a nightmare as he got on the bus. There was only one seat that was not filled with other people. Near the back of the bus. He had to sit near the back row with the senior students. The young boy gulped as he slowly moved to the back, the older kids giving him odd looks and strange smirks. As Sora sat down in his seat, he could hear chuckles coming from behind him and gave a sigh.
Something tells me this will be the death of me.
Beyond the chuckles and foreboding creep Sora got up his spine, the bus ride was uneventful. Though getting off the bus was a nightmare, it was as if the entire back row decided to get up and trample him in a sea of backpacks and shoves. Poor Sora was trapped in his seat until everyone had left the bus. Hilariously enough, finding his classroom was the only easy part of the entire day. Despite all the hecticness, he was able to find his classroom in a relatively short time. Sora sat down as homeroom was beginning. The teacher introduced himself and they were about to begin their first lesson when the door opened and two girls walked inside. One had long blonde hair while the other was bright red. Despite the contrasting hair colors, they were both very much alike facially. They must have been sisters.
Kairi and Namine Nomura. Please make an effort to be on time in the future. Mayor's daughters or not, I don't want to put you two in detention over something like this.
Upon hearing something about those two being the daughters of the mayor, Sora craned his neck to get a better view of them. His jaw dropped when he caught sight of the redhead. She was gorgeous. Even at the age of deciding girls were not so icky as he thought they were, he could admit she was very beautiful. The way her hair cascaded over her shoulders and covered one of her lovely eyes made Sora's heart skip two beats. His mind entranced a very dangerous thought. If he could just sit next to her, strike up a conversation, maybe he'd get to spend more time with this redhead. Maybe he'd actually get some friends on his first day. And if it's her of all people, that would just be the best. However, reality crushed in his daydream. It was then Sora remembered what he was in this school. A newbie. Of course everybody here was a newbie in this school, but Sora was the only one who came from another part of town. And judging by the way Kairi spoke to everyone, it was obvious she knew everyone in the classroom, except for Sora. He placed his head on the desk and he sighed sadly. He was only here for 5 minutes and already he felt more alone than ever. He already hated this school, and, for some reason, he began to hate the people here. Lunch was hell. This probably will not be the last time you hear something being compared to hell. As bluntly put as it sounds, lunch was currently hell on earth for Sora. He sat at a table alone, which was odd for a freshman not trying to converse with other freshmen, trying to make friends and all that. Sora was not antisocial, he was just shy, and unfortunately that shyness deprives him from a lot of things in life. So when Sora saw Kairi enter the lunchroom with a few friends of hers, he mentally pleaded that he didn't have to sit here alone. As odd as it sounds, he wanted company, but he didn't want to be the one to make the first move. Because the first move meant Sora would look like a fool if he was turned down. Most of Sora's life, he relied on people to make the first move. He was always the one who made the second, maybe third move, because he felt more comfortable making the second move, or third. It was a system that worked for Sora all of his life. Don't open yourself to mistakes, you never make any, and save your dignity. Sora heard Kairi and her friends talking, and he was able to pick up a few of the words they said.
I don't know about you guys, but I already hate high school.
A boy proclaimed. His dirty blonde hair fell in his face.
Come on, Tidus. The only reason you hate high school is because you actually have to put down 100% of your attention on work.
A silver-haired boy laughed.
Now, Riku. I seem to remember someone who kept passing notes to a certain Australian redhead in class.
A boy with bright orange hair grinned, a hint of Jamaican accent in his voice.
Hey, no need for personal attacks, Wakka. What about you and that goth chick I saw you talking to?
We're only friends.
Friendly terms with a girl who's antisocial with everybody but you? Sure.
No fighting, please.
Namine mumbled. Sora didn't even notice her there.
I don't want any yelling.
Okay, boys, settle down.
Kairi laughed.
Let's find a table.
Embarrassment took a hold in his gut as the group walked to him. Sora made sure not to make eye contact, for he feared they would see in his eyes the silent plea for them to sit next to him. They were coming closer. His heart began to flutter, and maybe he wouldn't have to sit alone during lunch.
Hey, Kairi! Over here!
Sora lifted his head and looked across the room. There he saw a girl with short, dark hair, with another girl with red hair, held up by two pigtails.
Yuffie! Vanille! Come on, guys, we can sit there.
Kairi pointed over to the other girls, and Sora felt his heart fall just as it rose earlier. He watched sadly as the group moved away from his table and over to the other one. He moodily stabbed his potato and cursed his hopefulness.
Sora? Sora Shimomura, I can't believe it!
Sora's head jerked up and he looked behind him, and he couldn't believe who it was either.
Tifa! Tifa Lockhart!
Sora gasped as a 16-year-old ran up to his table. Tifa Lockhart was neighbors with Sora when they were younger. She babysat him a few times when she was old enough. One day she transferred to another school and she and Sora hadn't seen each other since. However, seeing her now made Sora feel a little bit better. She always looked after him and helped to make him feel better when he was sad. Something Sora held on to a lot in his youth. She sat down at the table and she gave Sora a massive hug. Then she pulled away from him, and Sora just realized how much she changed over the years. She had much longer hair. She was definitely more taller and a little more... what was the word? Feminine. All Sora could think was that this girl could definitely capture the eyes of all the men in this room.
Oh my god! How long has it been? A few years?
Tifa laughed as she sat down next to Sora.
Yeah, that sounds right. You look different than I remember.
Well, what did you expect?
Tifa playfully socked his arm.
You look different than I remember as well.
Sora chuckled while rubbing the arm Tifa socked. Tifa giggled at Sora rubbing his arm and she tilted her head a little.
So, what are you doing here all alone?
Sora's smile dropped into a frown and he went back to stabbing his potato.
Oh, no reason. I like being alone. No chaos, no people to bug me. You know.
Sora shouldn't have been surprised that Tifa saw right through him. Her critical stare was all that was needed for Sora to amend his words and tell the truth.
I don't feel like I belong here. That's all.
Oh, come on. You're selling yourself too short. A guy like you could easily fit in here. Why don't you go talk to people?
Sora went red in the face and mumbled.
I don't know. I mean, I just moved here. Maybe I should wait a few days and then try.
Tifa sighed. She took Sora's arm and led him out of the chair.
I refuse to have you sit here alone. Now go, and make friends.
When Sora realized Tifa was not letting him back at the table until he at least talked to someone, he sighed, picked up his tray, and looked for someone to approach. Someone kind and friendly. Someone he found interesting. Please don't act surprised that Sora decided to approach the group of people with the very pretty redhead. I mean, what 14-year-old boy wouldn't? That's a rhetorical question, by the way. Don't answer that. Tifa sat back down and she watched him slowly walk over to the table across from him. Sora felt his heart begin to race as he edged closer to the table with Kairi and all of her friends. As he was walking, he was planning his greeting. It would go something like, "Hi, I don't want to sit with all the seniors, so do you guys mind if I sit here?" It was perfect. It didn't sound too needy, and he would be able to sit alongside them. He felt his heartbeat so powerfully, he was half afraid that someone might actually hear his heart racing. He was so close to the table and he had his greeting all planned out. But then by some misfortune, also known as spilled milk from a broken milk carton, Sora slipped. He fell forward and lost grip of his food tray, and it flew in front of him and landed on a certain redhead girl's clothes. Sora moaned in pain and he heard some distinct yelling. Then when he looked up, he realized the yelling was directed at him.
"You klutz!"
Tidus shouted as he grabbed a few napkins from the dispenser there.
"What's wrong with you, man?"
"No, it's okay. It was probably an accident."
"An accident? That guy practically threw it on you!"
"Aren't you going to apologize?"
He felt tears of embarrassment burn in his eyes. He quickly got up and he walked shamefully back towards his table. No words, no anything. He could still hear the demands and jeers of everyone behind them as he sat back at the table he was at before. Head buried in his arms, not wanting to look, not wanting anyone to see him cry, Tifa had her hand over her mouth in shock. And when she saw Sora silently pour tears of embarrassment, she felt tears of her own well up. It was then and there Tifa decided something. She turned to Sora and whispered in his ear,
"Meet me at the front of the school, after class. I have something to show you."
By like lightning that day, but the burn and pain of the lunchroom fiasco burned in Sora's mind. He walked out of the front doors and saw Tifa leaning against her car. When she saw Sora approaching, she waved at him and he ran over to her.
"Okay, I'm here. What did you want to show me?"
Sora asked. However, Tifa seemed to kind of zone out for a moment. She went to the crowd and waved at a boy with bright blonde spiky hair.
"Hi, Cloud."
Cloud looked back at her and waved, but then his attention turned to another girl who came out of the school. She had light brown hair, green eyes, her hair was in a long ponytail, and she wore a bright pink dress and brown shoes. She and Cloud talked for a bit, and then they both walked off to join another boy with dark brown hair. Tifa's face fell, and she kind of leaned sadly against her car.
"Do you like that boy or something?"
asked, looking at the blonde boy who had just walked off. Tifa didn't respond to his question. She just stared off at the retreating figure until he was a black blur in the blinding sunlight. Then she opened her car door and motioned for Sora to get in.
"I want you to meet some people. Some friends of mine I met when I first moved here."
What kind of people?"
asked, looking at the passenger side of the car. Buckling up, he heard Tifa's somber reply.
"People who know what it feels like to be alone."
Words. No questions were spoken during the half an hour of driving. Tifa parked the car in a parking lot, and then she led Sora to an alleyway across the road. They walked for a bit down the alley until they approached a secluded spot where a tarp covered a door-sized hole. Tifa pulled the tarp open and she disappeared for a bit. Then she came out and motioned for Sora to walk in. It seemed to be an empty space in the alleyway maybe once used for storage. It was filled with furniture, an arcade, a table or two, a few lamps, and a cooler out in the corner. A soft hum from the side came from the generator that was used to power some of these nice items. While the inside wasn't air-conditioned, it was comfortable. It felt homey, like that special place you have where you can just relax and forget about the world outside. After his moment of awe, he realized he was not alone. There was a bunch of people here, too. They each turned to Sora and they smiled warmly.
A newcomer?
Asked a girl with a black top and shorts.
Welcome.
His voice greeted. It came from a girl with short silver hair that obscured one of her eyes.
Yo, Tifa, who's this?
Paine, Fu, Rai, this is Sora. He's one of my friends.
For a moment, Sora felt a stab of worry. What if he was going to be rejected here just like at school? The boy known as Rai smiled at Sora, a smile that dashed all of Sora's worries in a single moment.
Any friend of Tifa's is a friend of mine. How you doing?
Sora smiled back. For some reason, even though he barely knew these people, he felt welcome here. He spent the next few minutes talking with these people and the feeling just blossomed from there. Rai Marino is from the upper north part of the city. He had two younger sisters and parents who were lucky if they even walked through the front door.
Can't say why they left. I don't even know myself. All I know is that I was suddenly the father and caretaker of two young girls who needed taken care of. For 5 years of my life, I sacrificed keeping them fed and safe. I had to do things most kids my age wouldn't dare do. But I did them because I love my sisters.
Where are they?
One of them's in juvenile hall, doing some time for repeated counts of petty theft. The other ran off with a boy who could promise her enough needles to escape reality.
Paine had a similar story to Rai, except her story differed in terms of their parents.
My mother had me when she was young, a one-night stand gone wrong, and she was soon alone and taking care of a young girl. She did it, though, got a job, raised me herself. Until last year. She fell ill, quite ill, and money is tight with medical bills stacking up. My mother, she was a good mother, even though her life was rough. No one saw that good in her, though. They only saw the teenage pregnant mother, who was now ill from her years of being an irresponsible teenager.
Fu was the only one who didn't talk of her story. When asked, she was only responded with one word.
Private.
Even as Sora related his own side of the story, he felt a sense of belonging here, for maybe the first time in his life. He heard a noise and he saw someone come into the room. He was tall with blonde hair tucked into his snow cap. He wore a white sleeveless jacket and he had a scar between his eyes.
Tifa, who's this?
The boy asked, jutting his head towards Sora.
Seifer, this is Zora. He's one of my friends and I thought he could fit here.
He's just like us. He doesn't seem to fit in with everyone.
The boy named Seifer looked back and forth between Sora and Tifa. Then he sighed and he said,
Tifa, let's talk for a moment.
Seifer turned to another tarp that led into a room with Tifa behind him. A small stab of dread entered Sora until a strangely comforting hand from Fu was guided to his shoulder.
He will understand. He always does.
A few moments later, Tifa walked out with Seifer. He turned to Sora. He motioned for him to follow him and he waited inside. Sora hesitated and then he walked inside. Seifer beckoned him to sit down.
Tifa told me you don't fit in with the people at the school. Maybe you can explain to me better on why?
Seifer asked, and Sora recapped his entire story about what happened to him, about his father and how no one seems to want to understand or talk to him, when he got into the lunchroom incident and how he couldn't seem to fit in everywhere he went. A light went up in Seifer's eyes.
They didn't give you a chance to explain.
Sora hesitated. The redhead Kairi might have listened, if her friends didn't interject otherwise.
No. No, they didn't. None of them.
That does seem bad.
There was a strange pause in the air, as if the young blonde was contemplating a decision.
Tell you what, Sora, how would you like to show them your pain?
Sora jumped a bit.
What do you mean? You mean kill them?
No, not kill them, just... show them what it feels like to be alone, to have them feel your sadness. Then maybe they can understand how you feel.
How would I do that?
Seifer's eyes narrowed.
Do unto them what they did unto you in that lunchroom.
Sora paused at this. Seifer could see his hesitation and he added,
I'm not forcing you. Tifa doesn't feel comfortable about it either. Ra, Fu, Paine, and I do it because, like you, we feel forgotten and alone. Sometimes being quiet doesn't produce the results we want. If we want people to listen, we need to kick and scream at them.
Sora saw it in Seifer's eyes. It echoed in pain and loneliness. I know that sounds like the lamest way to describe it, but those eyes of his may as well have been Sora's eyes. The same eyes he looked at in the mirror every morning of his life. Seifer stood up and he walked over to Sora.
If you don't feel comfortable, you could always...
No! I'm tired of being alone, and I'm tired of crying. I hate it more than anything.
Sora looked at Seifer. In that moment, he had stopped crying, stopped feeling sad. No, now he felt mad. Anger pulsed through him like his own heartbeat. He was grinning at the thought that people would yell at him, feeling his pain, his embarrassment and loneliness. If Sora was going to do unto them what they did unto him, then he was going to pay back their kindness tenfold.
I'm in.